Amen, and thank you, Sharman, and good morning. My name is Melissa. I'm the lead pastor here. I welcome you, those of you that are with us in person, those of you joining us online. Everybody take just a deep breath. I don't know about you, but when I sat down, I was like, oh, all right. You hustled in out of the cold. It was probably a crazy morning, maybe at your house or in the car, and there are all kinds of words exchanged on the way in, and now you're here. And we want to breathe together and experience the presence of the Lord, the joy of the Lord today on this third Sunday in Advent. If you are a guest joining, we especially welcome you. If you're online, you'll find some information there about how to connect. If you're here with us, I hope you grabbed a bulletin as you came in. If not, after the service, make sure to grab one of those. There's information on the back of that of how you can connect with us. Let us know about your visit. Let us know if there's something that we could pray for you and pray with you about. We would love to connect with you in that way. As we said, it is the third Sunday in Advent. And each Sunday of this season, we light a candle. The first Sunday, we lit the candle of hope. The second Sunday, we lit the candle of peace. And today, we light the candle of joy, the pink candle. Joy is one of those things, kind of like hope, that often is misunderstood. Sometimes we think of it as just sugary, happy kind of joy, this excitement about everything in life. And when you walk through life and you're told to have joy in all circumstances, you understand that it can't be sugary and sweet and just excitement all the time. True joy is joy that comes from an inner place in our lives that trusts the goodness and the faithfulness of God despite the circumstances, despite what's happening in our life. That is the joy of the Lord, which we celebrate today. We read in the text that when the angel came to Mary and announced that a special child was going to be born to her, she sang this beautiful song, and in it she said, I rejoice. I rejoice in the God's favor and the gift that God is bringing to me into the world. That's the joy that we talk about and that we celebrate today. Joy is a light in dark places. And this morning, we can think of so many dark places in our lives and our world around us that need the light of joy. And so today, we light this candle of joy, holding near to our hearts and in our prayers those places that are experiencing darkness today, in whatever form that is. We light this candle of joy for those who are grieving this season, for those who feel alone this season, for those who worry about tomorrow in this season. We light this candle of joy for all of us today as we remember that no sorrow or brokenness in this world can overcome us because Jesus has overcome the world. May the light of this candle say to all that the joy of the Lord is ours and with us in this world. Friends, do not be afraid. The joy of the Lord is with us. Let us pray. God of joy, it is in your love that we find lasting joy. Keep us from seeking happiness in things that will not last. Teach us instead, God, to find joy in the gift of your Son. May his joy fill our hearts and overflow to all we meet this Advent season. Amen.
If I invite you to stand, we sing together our theme song for this Advent, Jesus the Son of God.
Jesus the Son. Karen refugees are fleeing the country of Myanmar, formerly known as Burma. They are living in refugee camps over there. For many decades, the Karen people have been persecuted by the government over there and have endured many difficult things.
Between the Korean and the Burmese, forced people in the refugee camp live in Thailand long time. Our Korean people need the peace and justice and the freedom. United Nations, much of all, because America, did not go to that problem. Did not pay only because Niba Wada, do, the potato dollar, because all America pay in it.
When we first met her, she was helping in the Karen Children's Sunday School. She would help to lead them and to teach them scripture. When we would bring something to her, she would say, "We met some friends, some Karen friends here new in Oakland. Can you go and visit them? Can you bring them something?"
Pastor Ri and Lita, they brought the food and the family. We try to help our kids to grow here and to follow the Jesus, believe the Jesus, and love Jesus.
I'd like to invite you to stand this morning, if you're able, as we sing. And as we sing, O Come All You Faithful, the children are invited to come down and meet with Ryan here on the steps for children's time. Let's sing. One, two, three, four.
O come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Yeah.
Okay, so that football there, that's where Kansas City is. And down here at the bottom it says Jefferson City to Kauffman Stadium, 150 miles, 2 hours and 14 minutes. There's a baseball stadium where the Royals play in Kansas City. So it's like 2 hours away. It's not very far away. But if you look way up here in the corner where that little baseball is, that's where Seattle is. That's where my favorite baseball team is from. Way up there in the corner, all the way on the other side of the country. And it says it's 1,843 miles or 27 hours to get from there to Kansas City. That is a lot. Yeah. So if you were to start driving today, it would take you, and all you did was stop for gas, it would take you till like tomorrow at lunchtime to drive all the way out to Seattle, way out there. So that's really far away, right? Okay, so every year when my favorite baseball team comes to Kansas City, I like to go and watch them play. So they came in September a few months ago, and I went to the game, and I'm wearing my Mariners shirt, right? Because that's the team I'm rooting for. And it gets to the second or third inning, and guess what happens? The Mariners are batting. They hit a home run. So I stood up, and I cheered, and I clapped. And then a couple minutes later, guess what happened? Another home run. And I stood up, and I cheered, and I clapped. And then a few minutes after that, guess what happened? Another home run. And so I stood up, and I cheered, and I clapped. And a few minutes after that, another home run. And I stood up, and I cheered, and I clapped. And after that, guess what happened? No, they made the third out, and the inning was over. But four home runs in one inning. I've never seen that before when I've been to a game. Four home runs in one inning. Usually they don't hit four home runs in a whole game. And you know what happened every time? This is what happened. I stood up, and I cheered, and this is what it looked like. Everyone else sitting, and everyone else staring at me. And it was not a really comfortable feeling. And I was really happy for my team, but I felt kind of awkward and weird, right? And I felt kind of out of place, and I kind of felt like I didn't belong because there weren't a lot of other fans there for my team because they're so far away. And the ones that were there for my team, they sat way over on the other side of the stadium because that's where the team came in and out of the field. And so I didn't feel very good those times. I felt happy for my team, but I felt really weird every time I stood up and cheered and no one else did. And so sometimes that happens in life. We find ourselves in situations and places where we just don't feel like we fit in, and we feel like it's kind of weird, and we feel like we don't belong. And that's not a real good feeling sometimes. But you know, there is one place where we always belong, and that's when we're with God. God created each and every one of us. He loves each and every one of us. He wants us to spend time with him, talking to him, telling him about how our day is, telling him about our life. He wants us to know that he loves us so much and that we belong to him, right? And it doesn't matter if things are good or things are bad. It doesn't matter if we talked to him 5 minutes ago or 5 years ago. We always belong when we're with God. But, you know, there's one other place that we hope that we always belong, and that's right here at church. We hope that every time somebody walks through those doors out there on a Sunday or a Wednesday or any other time, really, we want them to feel like this is a place where they belong. Yeah, football too. And it doesn't matter if they cheer for the Chiefs or for the Royals or for the Mariners or what their life is like outside of here. We want them to feel like when they're here that they belong and that everybody that's here is a part of something, okay? And that this is a place for everyone. Yeah, so that takes each and every one of us to smile at people, to maybe share a handshake and a hello, to talk to people, to find out a little bit about them and make them feel welcome and make them feel like this is a place that they belong. Do you think that that's something we can do at this church to help other people feel like it's a place where they belong? Yeah, I think so too. All right, you can go back to your seats.
Invite you to stand if you're able. We're going to enjoy singing the first and last verses of two beloved carols. The Hark the Herald Angels Sing, and it came upon the midnight clear.
Our sermon scripture text today is Isaiah 40, 1 through 11, and can be found on pages 653 and 654 in the Pew Bible. I invite you to follow along in your Bibles or on the screens as I read aloud. Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries out, in the wilderness prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry out. And I said, what shall I cry? All flesh is grass. Their constancy is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades when the breath of the Lord blows upon it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Get you up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good news. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good news. Lift it up, do not fear. Say to the cities of Judah, here is your God. See, the Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him. His reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms, and carry them in his bosom, and gently lead the mother sheep. The word of God for the people of God.
Every valley
Thank you, choir, for bringing our text to light this morning through music. Will you pray with me? And now, God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts together be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Our culture seems to have a fascination with the wilderness and survival shows. Perhaps it's because we look around at the state of the world and we want to be ready as possible for an apocalypse, zombie or not. I began thinking this last week about how many movies and TV shows relate to the wilderness or survival. Season 10 of the TV show Alone debuted this summer. It is the History Channel's popular show where contestants are dropped off in some vast wilderness in the world somewhere with very few things. They get 10 survival items from an approved list and zero help. And then they're dropped off into the wild to survive the elements, the animals. They have to build a shelter. They have to find food and water. And the basic object of the show is to not die. And the one who wins is the last one to call for rescue. Well, there's also the show Survivor Man, which is the granddaddy of all the survivor shows, with survival expert Les Stroud. And it ran on various networks from 2004 to 2015, and it was the same premise. He was dropped off in these vast wildernesses all by himself. It was the first show to have the contestant film themselves so that they truly were alone, no team with them, as the same is in the Alone show. And then we have, if you might call it a survival show, Bear Grylls. If you can accept that sometimes he's not as in much danger as we think he is, and he definitely has a TV crew with him, but any of his mini shows, Man vs. Wild or the others, give you this experience of the wilderness and survival. And let us not forget, of course, the reality competition show Survivor, which is in its 45th season and multiple spin-offs of that show, where contestants form these tribes and they again battle the elements, usually on some tropical island. They have to build their shelter, make friends, build alliances, all those good things. And in the middle of that show, which is popular and continues to be a popular TV show, there's tribal councils, there's voting, there's immunity idols, there's backstabbing, there's betrayal, there's lies, all the things apparently we really love. Finally, at the end, the final tribal council votes and they decide who the sole survival is and they win the money for the show. The wilderness and survival entertainment industry has made lots of money for entertainment. There's something about it we love to watch and cheer and critique from the comfort of our chair at home with snacks in hands. We watch the show and we're like, I could have made a better alliance. I would have built a better shelter than that. I would never have lured a hungry bear into my campground. And when we watch it, it's kind of like when we watch TV or accidents. You can't hardly look away. We love the drama of the show, especially when it's not our drama. The wilderness is prime entertainment from the comfort of our homes. But when we find ourselves in the wilderness, especially in the abstract, the theoretical wildernesses, it's not so entertaining, is it? In fact, those kinds of wildernesses can be downright terrifying for us. There is, of course, the physical wilderness, the middle of nowhere places that seem empty and lonely and lacking in life and threatening from every side. And I'm going to guess few of us have much experience with that loneliness. It doesn't count if you get lost on a trail here in Jeff City and not sure how to get back to the parking lot. But we are familiar with the theoretical or abstract wildernesses of life. These can be things and times where we feel alone or empty or lacking in some way or feeling as if nothing will work out or we don't know what is going to happen next. There is the internal wilderness of disappointment and discouragement, doubt, fear, anxiety, grief, loneliness, wondering where is the God in the midst of this wilderness. You don't make the team or get the seat you wanted in band. Graduation is nearing, and everyone's asking, what are you going to do next? And you'd like to know too, but you don't have a clue. A marriage or relationship falls apart. Someone you love dies. The nest is empty for the first time and it's way too quiet. The bills came, the eviction notice arrived, and now the nest is not just empty, it's gone. The doctor delivers news that no one wants to hear. You're lost in the sea of expectations and obligations and notifications, your Google Calendar, a rainbow of colors that only promise exhaustion. Your faith has more questions than answer for the first time in your life. You're at the age when you've lost your license, your home, your independence, your health, and you're wondering, where is God in this new wilderness? These are some of the wildernesses some of us have been through, some wildernesses that some of you are walking right now. And sometimes it feels like life or God himself has dropped you right in the middle of this vast wilderness with no help at all, with simply a good luck. The people of Israel felt the same. Our text today finds them in the wilderness of exile for over a couple of generations, taken captive to a foreign land, far from home, far from everything that they knew. For centuries before, the prophets of old had reminded God's chosen people that they were called to be a holy people. Yet God's people often chose selfishness, injustice, and unfaithfulness. They ignored the needs of the poor while patting themselves on the back for all their good works. They failed to welcome strangers or care for widows and orphans. They cheated in business and in marriage. They worshiped false gods. Some pursued power and privilege. Very few pursued holiness. And the prophets warned that the unfaithfulness of God's people would lead to disaster. And about 6 centuries before the birth of Jesus, disaster happened. The Babylonians conquered ancient Israel. Jerusalem was captured, the temple destroyed, and the people were carried off into exile into a foreign land. And when our text today is written, Isaiah 40, the Israelites were still in this captivity, taken from their homes and families with nothing. The temple in Jerusalem, the place where God could be found, was burnt to the ground. Psalm 137 tells us that they had lost so much that they didn't even have a song to sing. It says in that psalm, "By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down, and there we wept when we remembered Zion. On the willows there we hung up our harps, for there our captors asked us for songs, and our tormentors asked for mirth, saying, 'Sing us one of the songs of Zion.' But how could we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land?" While in the wilderness of exile, they prayed and they pleaded for God to rescue them. They had broken the covenant with God, and the prophets of old had warned them of the consequences. So would God come to them in this wilderness of their own doing? Would God be faithful to them when they had failed to be faithful to God? Sometimes our wildernesses are the results of those who have gone before us. Generational trauma and pain. Sometimes our wildernesses are not the results of our choices, but sometimes they are. Sometimes we have no song to sing and only tears to cry because we've wandered far from the Lord, far from what gives life, seduced by the things that take life instead. Will God come to us in those wildernesses of our own choosing? Will God be faithful to us when we have failed to be faithful to God? Amid those questions, in the wilderness, after years of suffering, Isaiah 40 brings an entirely new word from God to the people through a prophet. It says, "Comfort, oh, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem. And cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins." you imagine what that word might have felt like? Like a man lost in the desert in need of a cup of water, God offers these words of relief. You've served your time and then some. The time of suffering is over, Israel. Yes, you made a mess of things, but I, your God, have not abandoned you. Yes, you were not faithful to me, but I, your God, am faithful to you. Nothing will keep me from you. Prepare the way for me to come to you. In verses 3 through 5, we read these words. A voice cries out. In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Notice how verse 3 says to make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Not a way to our God, but a way for our God. God is coming to us in our wilderness. God makes a way in the wilderness, whether our fault or not. In the very place of your fear, your pain, your brokenness, your loneliness, your confusion, whatever your wilderness is, God comes to us. We prepare the way. It's like a modern equivalent of rolling out the red carpet for someone important who is going to come. God is coming to us. And comfort was not all that God had to say to God's people. When the voice asked God, "What should I preach?" we hear this response. "Get up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good news. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good news. Lift it up, do not fear. Say to the cities of Judah, here is your God." Perhaps there is something to sing about once again. God's word for God's people in the wilderness when we aren't sure where we belong is this: comfort, here is your God. God is here. God comes with might because some things need to change. Mountains need to come down and valleys need to come up. Crooked ways need to be made straight. And God also comes in comfort, like a shepherd who gathers the lost sheep to his bosom and holds us and carries us. In the pandemic of 2020, it felt like a wilderness, didn't it? Life was upended, unpredictable. And in that season, when everything seemed up for grabs, we hungered for comfort and familiar, the predictable. I created routines in my daily life during that time, and they brought me comfort. One thing people did in that season was rewatch comfort shows. And in 2020, The Office was the most streamed TV show with over 57 billion minutes watched. Most of those were repeat viewers who knew the characters and what would happen. And so while life around us was changing rapidly, there were no surprises as they watched life unfold in Scranton, Pennsylvania. People didn't need to turn to a wilderness or survival show. They were living it. They wanted the comfort of familiar and known. And this is the same for us. When there's a lot of change or discomfort in our life, we hunger for what is known and comfortable, even if it's not life-giving. Eventually, the Israelites returned to their homeland, but it wasn't the same. The temple was destroyed. People in familiar places no longer existed. New generations born in exile were returning to a place that they'd only heard of, and I'm sorry, but that place didn't match the stories of those who had gone before them. Going back to the old ways was not an option. In the wilderness of exile where they didn't belong, and in a devastated city where they returned, the Israelites were reminded from the high mountain and the voice of the prophets of where they had always belonged. And that was with God. Even if their temple and old ways were gone, God remained. In whatever wilderness we feel lost in, and in every situation and place that no longer feels like where we belong, we're reminded where we always have belonged, and that is with God. No matter the zip code, no matter the circumstances, we belong with God. Friends, this is the anticipation of Advent. In those pandemic Advents, when our celebrations looked different and we didn't gather with families or in this sanctuary, our comfort has always been and must always be found in Christ the Messiah. When we gather next Sunday night for our Christmas Eve service, may the joy that we experience not be in the comfort of this place or in the traditions of that service, but rather in the long-awaited and fulfilled promise that God is here. Jesus, Emmanuel, God is with us. God has moved into the neighborhood. It would be 30 years after that night in Bethlehem before people would begin to understand who was right there among them. Even as John the Baptist told them to prepare for the Messiah's coming, they didn't know the Messiah was already here, living it up in Nazareth. The Savior was already in the neighborhood, but they were slow to recognize him, and many never did. He wasn't what they were expecting in a Messiah. But during their Roman wilderness, God was already there. God was at work. Is that not what we long to hear? Is that not good news for us today, for those of you who feel like you're in a wilderness of sorts? Maybe all you can see is the wilderness around you. Perhaps you have an expectation of how God will show up and rescue us in this world, and because of our expectations, we're missing how God is already at work, how God is already here with us in the wilderness. Isaiah's word from the Lord to the Israelites in their exile is a word to us today in whatever wilderness we find ourselves in. May this be the good news that we proclaim as we lift our voices and candles this coming Sunday night and for every day. We proclaim it for ourselves and for the world. Comfort. Here is your God. Comfort. Here is your God, right here, with you. With God is where you belong. Let us pray. Faithful God, some of us today feel lost in a wilderness. Perhaps of our own doing, perhaps because life is hard and heavy and overwhelming sometimes. People fail. Systems fail. There is heartache and pain in and around us, and we confess, God, that sometimes we feel like you've abandoned us, like you've dropped us off in some vast wilderness for us to survive on our own, to figure out our way home. We need to hear that you are near. We need to hear the words today from this high mountain. We need to shout these words for ourselves and everyone to hear. Comfort. Here is your God. Spirit of God, help us to prepare the way for you in our hearts, in this church and beyond. Help us, God, know how to join you in making crooked ways straight. Help us to remember that where we belong now and forever is with you. Amen. During this time, as we sing this hymn together, we invite you to respond, to pray from your seat, to pray as you sing. If you'd like to visit with me or one of the deacons during this song, we'll be out in the lobby over in this area. We'd love to pray with you. If you're looking to be a part of a faith community, if you want to know more about this Christ, God with us, we would love to share more about him with you. And so as we sing, as we reflect, we respond from wherever we're at and respond to the Spirit today.
Thank you.
Thank you, friends. It's been good to worship with you today. And as we prepare to enter this holiday week, there's lots of things going on. We know many of you will be traveling as well. And so we pray for safe journeys and good times with family and friends as we remember the hope that we have that Christ enters our world and is with us this season. Few announcements. You'll see a lot of this in your bulletin, so make sure to read that. But then next Sunday is December 24th, so a little bit of schedule change for the next two Sundays. So next Sunday we have worship at 9 o'clock, and then we'll have our Christmas candlelight service at 6 o'clock. They're two different services, two different words and music and everything. So we'll hope you'll be a part of those. If you could, if anyone is interested in helping, we need a few more greeters for the candlelight service at 6 o'clock. Greeters come here at 5:15. We man the doors, we help hand out candles and bulletins. And so if you would be interested in helping us welcome people to that service, would you just let me know after the service or send me an email? We want to make sure we have all the doors covered so that we're good hosts to those who come that night to gather. So that's next Sunday. The next Sunday, the 31st, we will not gather here together at all. It's a Sabbath Sunday. We're giving all volunteers and staff a day of rest. We encourage you to worship at home. You can join and visit another church that you've been wanting to, but you have to come back here in January, all right? But it's good. I like to go visit other churches sometimes and just to worship with them. You can watch any of our services online as well. So God is still with us, even if we don't gather that Sunday, but we appreciate the day of rest as we prepare for what God has ahead for us in the next year. I want to also remind you that we continue to search for volunteers for J.C. Ratty, and First Baptist has been tasked with covering the week of December 24th. Why? Because they think we're up for the challenge of the holiday week. So if you could fill in any of those spots, there's a few still open. You can go to our website there. The information is in the bulletin. There's ways to sign up and be a part of that, even if you've never done that before, and they'll show you how to help serve our guests who are staying down in our gym during these cold weather months. And last, we do thank you for your faithful giving. A few reminders, it's also in your bulletin. You can give to our regular offering at the boxes, but if you want to make end-of-year gifts, note that in the bulletin about when those deadlines are here before the end of the year is up. Now, would you receive this blessing as we go, whether to our classes or out into the world, to be the people of God? While we wait, let us be God's people, people of steadfast love, people of unending faithfulness, people of justice and righteousness, people of peace who follow the Prince of Peace, the one who is coming soon. Amen.